Okay, from a Labor perspective, how would you sum up the year? Clearly there have been difficulties for the government. A successful 2017 for your lot?
Look, for us, we've had a great year. We've finally got the government to agree to a Banking Royal Commission after the Prime Minister convincingly telling the public 22 times, no less than 22 times, that we didn't need one. We now have a Prime Minister that has finally agreed to give the Australian people what they've been asking for. So I guess we'll mark that up as a Labor win.
Well, same-sex marriage was another one on your agenda too. That's been ticked off.
I think I said it in my speech, Andrew, that I would have really liked to have arrived at that position without the costly and divisive marriage equality survey. We saw it get voted down in the Senate, and then, of course, the High Court challenge, and then there was a backdoor with Malcolm Turnbull, who is the Prime Minister, who is supposed to be leading this country, take the backdoor option and get it in another way. That cost a lot of people. It took a big toll on people, and I think that I'm really happy to have arrived here, and I am looking incredibly forward to attending lots of weddings next year and watching my friends finally be recognised the same way everyone else can be recognised.
And Jane, how do you think the year went for your side of politics?
Well, for us it was a year of achievement. When you look at the jobs growth, more than 380,000 jobs in a year. That's more than 1,000 a day. And 4 out of 5 of those are actually full-time jobs, record number of women in employment, economic growth, 5 consecutive quarters of economic growth. And these things don't happen by accident. This is because we have a government working hard to deliver, not just locally with issues such as incentives for small business with tax relief, but equally our trade agreements with many countries have seen record growth in exports. I think it's table grapes. We're now exporting at more than 216% increase. Cheese, red wine, beef. There's a whole lot of increase in our exports. And so it's important that we make sure that that continues. And that's not just benefiting our service industry, industries and employers in those sort of areas, in city areas, but also our regional producers. And that's the important part of maintaining this economic growth into the year ahead.
That said, it's the internal divisions within the coalition that have made the headlines this past year. So it must have been a very frustrating year for you.
Well, at the end of the day, though, we have achieved a lot, and we're a united team going forward. Unlike Graham Richardson this morning, who came out and slammed Bill Shorten for doing a deal with the CFMEU, I think there could be some internal challenges ahead there.
And Emma, on the dual citizenship saga, that didn't discriminate. Both sides of politics, all sides of politics, in fact, got caught up with that. But particularly with Labor, given that you were so adamant that your processes were in place to make sure that everyone was okay.
Yep.
But there wasn't a good look for Labor.
Look, I think the difference between us and everyone else that's been embroiled, not so much the independent that's been caught up, the difference is night and day. Our guys have been through the processes and they've actually checked. Barnaby Joyce didn't check. Fiona Nash didn't check. John Alexander didn't check. The three that they keep pinning on us and saying, you know, these guys are in massive amounts of trouble, they've all checked, they've all put in their paperwork, they've all done the things that were required of them that say take all reasonable steps. When you don't bother to check, as in the case of the three that I've just mentioned, that's where we see we're in trouble. And we've still got Julia Banks, who may or may not be of Greek, dual nationality. And that's going to be an issue that takes us forward. But of course, we all know that we had the opportunity to deal with this the last week of Parliament, and Malcolm Turnbull and the Liberals actually voted to not deal with it. So this will follow them into the new year, and it will be something that again distracts. And obviously with all of that, we saw the extraordinary step of Parliament being cancelled for a week, where 53 other pieces of legislation couldn't be dealt with.
Yeah, Jane, it is bad news for the Australian voter because there's the likelihood that we'll face more by-elections.
Well, I'm confident there won't be any by-elections caused by anyone on our side of the Parliament. I am concerned that Labor, who said they had a foolproof system, clearly don't, and people like David Feeney and others may be causing by-elections continuing into the new year.
I think the issue with David Feeney is that he took the steps. He's Irish and British, and you've got the extraordinary case where he's confined his paperwork for his Irish stuff but not his British stuff. So why would you seek to clarify only one part of your citizenship and not both of them. So I think, you know, David Feeney, he's referred himself, he's done the right thing and fessed up. I mean, obviously Stephen Parry let it all go through. There was senior ministers on Jane's side of the fence that said, oh, we knew about this but we did nothing. So look, you know, they'll keep slinging mud, but at the end of the day I think that our processes were watertight, especially having gone through that myself, but being repeatedly told that I was in sort of some kind of strife, but having taken all those steps myself, can you know, categorically say we do have those checks and balances in place.
But doesn't it show that perhaps those processes weren't watertight, considering there are still some question marks?
Well, the question marks are only around the timing of when the countries that they sought information from came back to them. That would be then our High Court reflecting on a junior public servant in the British Home Office stamping and ratifying something. I mean, we saw John Alexander and Fiona Nash has come back really quickly. I think the turnaround was 3 days. So the people that they keep calling into question on our side actually put their paperwork in and waited for a response.
Well, let's look at a couple of issues that I know both of you wanted to bring up. And Jane, we'll start with you. In the news recently, we've seen some horrific scenes on our roads. Now, I know that you, in particular, are very concerned about what's going on at the moment as far as road safety is concerned.
Yes, Andrew, look, clearly it's not an issue for federal politics, although we have got a review going on at the moment. But it's really a plea to all your viewers and everyone tuning in. Please, Emma and I and our colleagues always say stay safe over Christmas and the New Year, but it really is a genuine plea. I cannot understand in these days when we have the best roads, the cars have never been safer, education for learner drivers has never been better, it's harder to get a licence than ever before, and yet just in a few weeks of Christmas we've had 7,000 speeding fines in Queensland alone. You know, one driver doing 216 in a 110 zone, another one doing 180 in a Legacy Way tunnel. You know, I just don't know what can we do. People complain to politicians about don't bring in more regulations, don't become a nanny state. But what do we do to keep people safe? It's just such a tragic loss of life.
Emma, what do we do, given Jane was saying the safe cars, the best roads, we've got consequences already in place? Is it just a matter of the driver not taking responsibility and pushing the boundaries?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we were talking about this earlier, that people put a lot of pressure on themselves at this time of the year. You know, the Christmas is the deadline, and Christmas, you know, we've got to get this done by Christmas or by the new year going forward. We put a lot of pressure on ourselves to get things done. I mean, a lot of people are off work. Why are we rushing? You know, there's going to be a lot of those accidents that have been, you know, once the investigations are done, they involve speed, they involve human error, they involve driver error, people not doing the right thing. Look, I think a nationally consistent licensing scheme that Anthony, my colleague, raised the other day, you know, there are drivers who go and shop the states for various licences. That could be dealt with. That something that Jane was just talking about. You know, what do we do? Well, they could do that right now. That's something that the government could take action on. And I think that at the end of the day, it is actually about being responsible for yourself behind the wheel.
And Emma, another issue at this time of year, people look forward and say, okay, what's 2018 hold for me? And job security is certainly becoming an issue as we're seeing much, you could call it a revolution in the workforce. And I know in particular you're concerned about the casualisation of the workforce.
Absolutely. I think, you know, people do not pay bills on a casual basis. They don't get home loans on a casual repayment basis. They don't have to eat on a casual basis. So this idea that we shift and have all these employees on casual rates or on casual contracts is quite problematic. I mean, it's happening throughout the teaching sector. There are a lot of people in our public schools who can't get permanent jobs even. So it's not just the retail workers or people that are in insecure work in those traditional industries where we would find it. It's happening everywhere, moving over to contract, or people becoming sole contractors. I think that there is a need to actually address this and provide some security for people. Sure, we're not going to go back to 20 years ago where people have the same job for 40 years like my grandfather and my father did, but we need to actually provide some security and some stability for families out there.
Jane, is casualisation of the workforce a concern, and where do businesses come into that?
Well, look at the facts. 383,000 new jobs just in the last 12 months, and 4 out of 5 of those are actually full-time. So I don't think you could call that a casualisation of the workforce. But I'd just like to point out, I have my own business for 20 years, and there are a lot of employees out there who want to be casuals. And I had a lot of employees who I valued, who I particularly wanted to be full-time so I could make sure they were working for me when I needed them. And they used to prefer to be casual because it meant that they could work the hours and times they wanted. So I don't think it should all be one-sided here. We need to realise that a lot of employees enjoy the opportunity of being a casual employee so they can work to suit their own situations at home or other activities.
Which I think is fine if people have a choice. I think when they have a choice and they choose that, sure, that's their choice. But also we need to account for those people who don't have a choice. I have a woman in my electorate who's been working the same casual job for 20 years and cannot get part-time or full-time. Now, she's an older lady, she's got rent to pay, and she relies on shifts. So I think that if people have the right to ask and to be given more secure work, that's fine. If you want to choose to be a casual, you choose that. But it's about having the choice and the option.
All right, we're almost out of time. Jane, just finally, we spoke about the possibility of the electorate facing some by-elections next year. What about a federal election? Is there an expectation that Australia will go to the polls?
No, not at all. Not at all. Not till 2019. Next year, we've got lots of great opportunities coming up. I'd like to finish on a high for 2017, which was, of course, qualifying for the World Cup and winning the Ashes back. And I hope that next year will be just as successful in the sporting arena. In fact, as I came into the studio, I just ran into Leighton Hewitt, and I thought probably your viewers would be more interested in his views on the years past and the year ahead.
And Emma, what's your big moment for next year? What are you looking forward to?
Look, I think we'll be fighting for people's penalty rates. We'll be fighting for people's jobs, unlike we've had Malcolm Turnbull fighting to hang on to his job all of the year through. Climate change and energy and gas security, I think, is a massive issue. We would have liked to have dealt with that this year. Unfortunately, we didn't see any action. So I think that'll be a massive opportunity to go forward for next year. But like Jane said, you know, there's a couple of sporting highlights coming up next year. We've been enjoying the cricket and, of course, the Sydney to Hobart over the last couple of days. So, you know, but that'll all happen irrespective of what we're doing in Canberra.
Absolutely. All right, Emma, thanks so much. And Jane, to you also. Happy New Year.
Thanks, Joe. Thanks, Andrew. Happy New Year, everyone.
See you, Jane.
Bye, Emma.